afternoon and welcome everyone to the third in the series of webinars. Today's webinar is going to focus on the conversations which are aiming towards safe abortion access for pregnant persons in India, post-pandemic and beyond. We have two speakers with us here today, and I would like to introduce them first. We have Aparna Chandra, who teaches at the National Law University, Delhi, where she also heads the Center for Constitutional Law, Policy and Governance. She has recently co-authored a casebook titled Securing Reproductive Justice in India. She is also currently undertaking a study on legal barriers to accessing safe abortion in India in collaboration with the Center for Reproductive Rights. Our second speaker today is Mrinal Satish. He is a professor of law at the National Law University, Delhi. He is the former chairperson of the Delhi Judicial Academy. Mrinal specializes in criminal law, and he focuses in particular on laws relating to sexual violence and on sentencing. So we welcome both our speakers here. And before we start the conversations for the day, I would like to invite Alka Barua to give us a kind of a summary, you know, take us through what was discussed in webinar one and two, and also give us the context and objectives for today's webinar. So Alka, over to you.
Thank you, Suchitra. Good afternoon, everyone. Once again, welcome to the third webinar hosted by Common Health and Priya. I will summarize the discussions and deliberations in the first two webinars. In the first webinar, we covered the legal environment and reforms over time, and also experiences other movements had in pursuit of decriminalization of specific sections of the Indian Penal Code. The first webinar also called our attention to the stigma and chilling effect of the criminal provisions despite the amendments and reforms. Called our attention to the complexity of issues involved in decriminalization and the need for a more nuanced and broader approach to decriminalization. The second webinar, which happened a week ago, specifically looked at access of women, particularly vulnerable women, to abortion services. And against the background of public health system infrastructure and programs, particularly in the context of the current pandemic and the health crisis. In the first session of the second webinar looked at access and vulnerability. In this session, Manisha laid the ground for discussions on intersection of law and access to services. And while identifying the absence of women at the center of the current laws as the core issue, she also talked about exclusion and inclusion of certain women under the current law, which was against the very grain of non-discrimination, state obligation for safeguarding women's rights, and substantive equality for women seeking services, the three fundamental principles of CEDAW convention to which India is a signatory. Shruti and Shampa shared the difficulties faced by vulnerable groups such as young women and persons with disabilities. Shruti talked about how laws, policies, and programs treat young people as a homogeneous constant group, and how young people face challenges in accessing specifically reproductive health services because of mandatory reporting under the POXO that compromises confidentiality. Shampa also talked about how laws, acts, and policies treat people with disabilities as minors who have no rights and who need guardians for provision of consent. She also talked about how informed consent had very little meaning in the context of those with disabilities, as the information is rarely or rather almost never in disabled-friendly format. She elaborated on how stipulations about consent in the current act are based on extent of disability and have the potential to be misused. All the three speakers mentioned that crisis situations further limit vulnerable people's access to safe, affordable, timely, and confidential services. And the focus as it is currently on relief measures often sidelines the other rights. Vinoj and Kalpana talked about the health system scenario, especially in the current crisis, and also talked about the implications for service access. Vinoj described how facilities have been repurposed now and staff has been redeployed at the cost of regular routine services at the health centers. And in the lockdown period, the absence of transport, suspension of outpatient facilities, lack of supplies have further compounded the problem. Kalpana mentioned that as such, there is no specific program or coherent strategy for access to safe abortion. stigma and scant respect for women's autonomy has been and continues to be at the root of access problems and contradictions between laws, acts, policies, and program contents, as well as the crisis situations, succeed in disenfranchising the vulnerable even further. All of them articulated their apprehensions about the likelihood of increase in unwanted pregnancies, second trimester abortions, cost of services because of even preventive measures and exploitation by private sector, and also increase in poverty. And they their apprehensions were that all this will lead to an increase in unsafe abortions when the lockdown is sort of lifted. Suchitra then presented her analysis of the recent amendments to the MTP Act and described how these did not address any of the challenges mentioned earlier, nor did they include any measures to improve access. The approach of addressing women's needs continued to be need-based rather than right-based, and the framing of stipulations and messaging was still in the context of patriarchy. Now, both Common Health and CREA strongly believe that right to take decisions that have implications for health and life are every individual's right, including the right to safe abortion services. And perhaps the time has come to remove the legal impediments to exercising these rights. Common Health and CREA also believe that there is a greater potential for success if all of us work together. And therefore, we conceptualize these webinars as platforms to bring together all allied and partner organizations to create a broad-based and common understanding of decriminalization and its implications for safe abortion rights, and to also deliberate on advocacy strategies. So today's webinar 3 is aimed at reflecting on the deliberations of the earlier two webinars and obtaining a clearer understanding of collective advocacy goals, implications of the potential outcomes of the different pathways, and on the possible domains of collective strategies for going ahead. So with this, I'll hand over to you, Suchitra, or does Aparna come in directly?
Yeah, I'll just get that started. Thank you so much, Alka. That was a very succinct summary of the last two webinars. And it is in the backdrop of this entire landscape that Alka has described in terms of our conversations, as well as the understanding of barriers and access issues and ideological issues that were deliberated upon. I would now invite our next two speakers. Each one of them has 10 minutes. And once they've both spoken, we will have some time for discussion. So please do take notes of anything that you would like to ask or talk about. And I will now invite Aparna. She will be speaking to us about the pros and cons of the existing law and proposed amendments in the context of the availability of safe legal and rights-based services. Aparna, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Suchitra. Let me just share my screen. Okay, is my screen visible?
Yes, it is to me.
Okay, great. Right, so I am going to focus my presentation on the current law as we have it today, the proposed amendments, the pros and cons of both, and opportunities for strategizing around advocacy that opens up in the difference between the present law and the law that is proposed. Okay, so just to begin to recap a point that's been made in the previous two webinars, in India, women don't have a right to abortion. They don't have a right. There is no obligation on a medical practitioner, on a registered medical practitioner, or on the state to provide abortion. What legal framework we do have is that the power to provide abortion and the power to decide whether abortion should be provided or not is shifted to the hands of registered medical practitioners. So for the registered medical practitioner, what does the decision look like? What is the decision tree in deciding whether to provide an abortion or not? Let us look at the RMP's decision tree of whether to provide abortion or not. If the RMP does not provide abortion, there is no legal consequence that follows for the RMP. If the RMP does decide to provide abortion, then abortion is a criminal offense under the IPC, and there are other range of laws under which there might be some criminal consequences for, or other legal consequences for, the RMP. Now, what the MTP Act does, it says that there is a small window of exception to the criminal offense. So if you fall within this exception of the MTP, then the provision of the abortion is not a crime. Now, those exceptions deal to who can provide abortion, where can they provide abortion, under what circumstances, with whose permission, etc. Now, if you've provided abortions and you don't fall within these exceptions, then of course all the legal consequences will follow. Similarly, if you are in violation of any of the other laws that regulate abortion services or that have an influence on providing abortion, then there might be legal consequences that follow. So then, what is the path of least resistance for an RMP? It is to deny abortion care, because there's no consequence to legal consequence to denying abortion care. If you do decide to provide abortion, then for a rational RMP, rational in a very economic sense, rational RMP would want to mitigate their own risks. And they mitigate their risks by asking for additional requirements over and above what the MTP Act actually requires. So additional consent requirements, for example, seek spousal consent, seek parental consent even for adult women, ask the police's permission, ask the court's permission, or make women run through hoops, come back in a few days. You want to make sure that you're actually wanting this abortion, so have a cooling off period, so on and so forth. And these additional hoops that women are made to run through, they end up denying them timely abortion care, or denying them care, timely and safe abortion care completely. Now, this is just an overview to explain, how the legal landscape is laid down. Let me come to the provisions in and of themselves. Mrinal will go through this in more detail, but the Indian Penal Code, as I mentioned, makes a provision of abortion an offense. Especially Section 312 encapsulates this idea. It says that whoever provides abortion to a woman, they use the language of miscarry, but if the miscarriage is not for the purpose of saving the life of the woman, then that's an offense and there's penalties that follow. And it says that a woman who causes herself to miscarry is within the meaning of this section. So if a woman provides her own abortion, then or seeks abortion outside of the seeks abortion, she falls within the ambit of this provision. What the MTP Act does is it creates an exception to these IPC provisions. It says if you provide abortion within the framework of the MTP Act, then that action is not a criminal offense. Now let's look at where the MTP Act 71 was coming from and where the MTP Act amendments 2020 are coming from. The MTP Act 1971, in its Statement of Objects and Reasons, says that abortion is being provided, is being liberalized, in their language, liberalized on health, humanitarian, and eugenic grounds. This is basically law speak for saying that abortion is being provided based on national priorities of that moment. What are those national priorities? Reducing maternal mortality and morbidity, population control, and eugenics. So, structuring the population in terms of what an ideal population should look like. So if you look at the parliamentary debates that take place and the justifications that the government is offering for why it's bringing this law and why it has specific provisions, these are basically the kind of reasonings that are being given, that this is good for the country. It's not about women. It's not about women's rights. It's not about women's health. It's good for the country because in the international sphere, India is being shamed because of its high maternal mortality, morbidity. It needs to control its population. And then you want ideal citizens, and citizens who are disabled or citizens who are the product of rape are less than ideal. And the idea that this is the concern was, of course, the big backlash was, well, if you provide easy access to abortion, then women will become promiscuous. And there was, that is where you have provisions like the population control, the contraceptive failure as a ground for providing abortion was restricted to married women. And the Statement of Objects and Reasons says, listen, don't worry, most of these mothers are married women. They are not under any particular necessity to conceal their pregnancy. So we are not enabling women who might want to conceal their pregnancy because they are not married to get easy abortions. Very much flowing into sort of this patriarchal mindset of when is sex permissible for women, when is sex not permissible for women, and what will be the consequences for, you know, control of women's bodies if we allow for abortion. Now, if you look at, there's something that's happening on my screen, not my doing, but please ignore that. If you look at the MTP Act Amendments 2020 and the Statement of Objects and Reasons, it's very interesting that the language, while it also replicates the language of maternal mortality, morbidity, etc., is now talking about ensuring the dignity, autonomy, confidentiality of women. And I think there's a space here. The space here is to say that, listen, these are the objectives that you are setting out for yourself. You are setting out for the law. And we don't think that the provisions that you have are actually going to meet these objectives. This is definitely something that, you know, in broader advocacy can work. In court-based advocacy, this is a tried and tested technique of saying that, you know, the objects of the law are not in, or well, the provisions of the law are not in consonance with the objects of the law. I think there's space here to say that if you want to ensure the dignity, autonomy, confidentiality, and justice for women, then you need to rethink your paradigm of abortion regulation. Okay, so then let's go to the provisions themselves. Now, what does the MTP Act say? MTP Act says that regardless of what you have in the Indian Penal Code, a registered medical practitioner shall not be guilty of any offense under that code if the pregnancy is terminated in accordance with the provisions of this Act. Note that it doesn't say anything about the woman. Though the IPC criminalizes the act of the woman itself, a woman herself, the MTP Act doesn't say anything about the woman who is seeking abortion. It only protects the RMP. Now, in practice, it has meant that if, you know, if a woman has sought an abortion in compliance with the terms of the MTP Act, she will not be prosecuted. But the consequence of this is felt in other areas of law. It is felt, for example, in matrimonial laws, where when a woman has had an abortion without her husband's consent, that is termed as cruelty and therefore is a ground for divorce. And in that context, judges tell us that when you know, people raise the idea, the point that, well, the MTP Act permits abortion, the argument is, right, the argument is that you have that the argument in that case is that the MTP Act does not protect the decision of the woman, and so then she can her decision is still subject to legal scrutiny. This has been unchanged. I am completely already out of time, but what I'm going to do is very quickly say that what the MTP Act, the new amendments have done is they've extended the time period within which you need you need the permission of only, or the sign off of only one RMP, the time period in which you need the sign off of two RMPs, but it's in a limited category of groups who might be able to access abortion in that space. We have the rules will be formulated, and there's space for advocacy there. And subsequent to 24 weeks, it will be for the to determine whether abortion is permitted or not. Now, the one big change here is that up to 20 weeks, sorry, I'm just wanting to make sure that I'm being heard. So, okay, up to 20 weeks, a woman who alleges that the pregnancy resulted from contraceptive failure can access abortion. Now, that's a big change from before, where this was permitted only to married women. I'm going to rush through, but just to say that beyond 24 weeks, what the Act does is requires the constitution of a medical board. Now, the current MTP Act doesn't have any provisions for medical boards. They came in through court judgments, and that's now being legislated into the law under the 2020 MTP amendments. There are a range of issues here that we need to look at, and this will depend on the rules that are framed. One, what are substantial fetal abnormalities for which abortion would be permitted? Two, is the board to be constituted at a state level or at the district level that would mediate access? And what will be the terms of reference of the medical board? What is it that they have to look out for? These are questions that that the rules will provide for, and that's a space where we might want to intervene. Okay, and I will just let me just get to then the main point. Is decriminalization going to be enough to get us to where we want to be, which is for the provision of safe, accessible, comprehensive abortion care? I don't think MTP by itself, decriminalizing abortion from the IPC or removal of the MTP Act is not going to be enough, because there are other laws that need to be factored in. I also think it was going to be counterproductive. We hear so often from service providers that personally they would not want to provide abortion, but because the law provides it, therefore they provide that abortion service, particularly in the public sector space. So in that situation, if you remove even this very problematic framework, this space that there is to negotiate with a public service provider, public sector service provider, also goes away. So then the next step is legalization, which is that there should be no adverse legal consequences on the pregnant woman. And that has to be rooted in thinking of abortion as a right. And so this would mean that no adverse legal consequences, for example, in the family law sphere. And that's something that we have to think about. But the third would be a rights-based legislation, which obligates the state to secure safe, accessible, and comprehensive abortion care. And there are models for this. Nepal has a model. It has its own problems, but it has a model. There have been efforts, decriminalization, but also, you know, rights-based efforts in many countries around the world in recent times. This includes Ireland, New Zealand, Australia in the very recent past. I would just say that maybe a big advocacy strategy for us then is to think of what a model law on abortion would look like, and to think together and to come up with a model law of abortion that we can then present as an alternative to say, hey, this is what a safe, comprehensive, accessible abortion care would look like in terms of a law, and the MTP Act is not enough. Okay, sorry for rushing through. I will stop here and then happy to take questions.
Thank you so much, Aparna. That was very interesting, particularly your last, suggestion for advocacy by developing a model law. We will be having time for discussions afterwards. So I would just request everyone to please take note of any points they would like to specifically ask Aparna. And I will now request Mrinal to share his thoughts with us about the pros and cons of decriminalization. Mrinal, you have 10 minutes.
Right. As Aparna has already spoken about the IPC framework, and all of us are aware of the IPC framework in the context of criminalization of abortion. So that's in Chapter 16 of the IPC of Offences Against the Human Body, and it's termed as of causing miscarriage, injuries to unborn children, and exposure and concealment of births. So we have sections 312 to 318 that deal with the issue. And I think concern for us is actually sections 312, 314, and 315, because the other four sections are not, one is of course causing miscarriage without woman's consent, I guess we should criminalize, and the others are sections are not particularly on the issue that we are focusing on. So section 312 says whoever voluntarily causes a woman with child to miscarry shall, if such miscarriage be not caused in good faith for the purpose of saving the life of the woman, be punished. And of course, explains that a woman who causes herself to miscarry is within the meaning of the section. Similarly, section 314 would be more from the perspective of someone who provides the services, which says, were with the intent to cause the miscarriage of a woman, which child does any act which causes death of such woman shall be punished. And if the act is done without the woman's consent, shall be punished with higher punishment. And 315 says that whoever before the birth of any child does any act with the intention of thereby preventing that child from being born or causing it to die after its birth, and does by such act prevent that child from being born alive or causes it to die after its birth, shall, if such act not be caused in good faith for the purposes of saving the life of the mother, be punished. So I guess 315 will also come into those frameworks of more late-term abortions, where if something like this were to happen, 315 would get covered. So the first question that we ask anytime there's a proposal to criminalize is what is the harm that the criminalization is seeking to rectify. So what are we trying to prevent? And so if we go back to the 1837 IPC and Lord Macaulay and his colleagues of the Law Commission, when they got into the issue of why criminalize, now this is an extract from note M of their deliberations. And if you see, basically the entire framework within which they're looking at abortions is that it leaves a stain on the honor of families, and so it's more about the stigma that it can cause to families, etc. But see the last part which I've highlighted. They say we're inclined to think that it would be our duty to advise a lordship in council rather to suffer abortion where the mother is a party to the offense to remain wholly unpunished than to repress it by provisions which would occasion more suffering to the innocent and to the guilty. So they actually, the earlier part would say that there should be provisions in this code of criminal procedure as to who can complain about this, and thereafter they seem to indicate that they don't want to criminalize abortion when it's done by the mother herself. Thereafter, just before the IPC was enacted and brought into force in 1860, you had the first report of the Law Commission, which looked at the recommendations that Macaulay and his colleagues had made, and again have detailed notes on each of the sections of the IPC. There, they note that abortion, in the way that it was framed in the IPC, it was not actually punishable in England. So they note that look, this is not punishable in England. The IPC was seen as the codification of the law at that point of time, and point out that it's not. And they say it's actually an offense in France, but not in England. And again, they say that we should only criminalize miscarriages caused without the consent of the woman. And the concern remains the same, misuse, stigma, etc. So if you get back to the rationale, because if you see the framers of the IPC, they didn't seem to want to criminalize abortion by the woman herself. We have moralistic grounds. I guess in one of the webinars, this has already been discussed. You have moralistic grounds on the basis of which you criminalize. You would say that fetus is a person and a rights-bearing entity, although we already have the position in international human rights law, which doesn't provide the fetus with that sort of personhood or rights-bearing entity. The IPC itself, in the explanation to Section 299, which defines homicide, says that the child will be considered a person only after any part of its body is brought forth, which is delivered. So until that point of time, it's not a human. And if you look at the definition of male and female in the IPC all put together, it seems to indicate that again, the fetus within the IPC is also not considered a rights-bearing entity. And of course, we have recent judgment of the Supreme Court, the right to privacy case, Justice Puttaswamy versus Union of India, and child marital rape decision of Independent Thought versus Union of India, both of which say that reproductive autonomy is protected under Article 21 of the Constitution. So in the context of the entire criminalization rationale, the two others that we have discussed, it seems to fall if you take this interpretation into consideration. So just to quickly go through data on criminalization of Section 313 to 318, this is from the report of the National Crime Records Bureau, the Crime in India report. I've taken the last 2 years. So if you see the number of cases under all these sections 313 to 318, in 2017, there were 1,872 cases, and in 2018, reduced by a bit to 1,728 cases, out of which around 180 were cases under 315 and 316, which we're not concerned with. The states with the highest number of cases, both in 2017 and 18, remained the same. Maharashtra with the highest, MP coming in second, and Karnataka coming in third. In terms of cities, Delhi and Bangalore remained the two cities with the highest number of cases. In 2017, Lucknow was number three and Mumbai number four. They were tied at number three, whereas Lucknow goes out in 2018 and Mumbai remains at number three. And then if we specifically look at sections 313 and 314, the number of cases in 2017 is 266 and 2018 is 216. And here you see a completely different picture in terms of the state, sort of, with UP being with the highest number of cases in both years, and MP and Maharashtra in 2017 replaced by West Bengal and Assam in 2018. In terms of charge sheeting rates, actually this is quite a high charge sheeting rate. You see around 48.1% in 2017 and 52.4% in 2018. and conviction rate 38.1% in 2017 and 18.2% in 2018. The interesting element is the next one. If you look at the number of arrests, you see that more men are arrested under these provisions than women. And again, more men are charge sheeted for these offenses against women. Again, one thing is because the data is not completely desegregated. We don't know which are these particular sections they are talking about. But it also seems to indicate that not too many women are being arrested, at least under these sections. And to come to the impact of criminalization itself, this is something that we have also discussed in the past. A woman's need to have abortion is, of course, not dependent on whether abortion is legal or not. However, access to safe abortion is definitely impacted by criminalization. Why? Because criminalization has a labeling function. It labels people as criminals, stigmatizes them, and makes people go underground, be it the service provider or the woman seeking the services herself. So therefore, the access to safe medical services are hampered. And as discussed last week in the webinar, reliance on unsafe practices impact women from marginalized groups and lower socioeconomic groups disproportionately, right? Frameworks that create exception to criminalization, like the MPP Act, lead definitely to unnecessary barriers, as we are seeing, to availing necessary health services. It gives decision-making power, like Aparna was discussing, to the RMP rather than to the woman herself. And the woman's agency is impacted. It forces women to carry pregnancy, which she does not want, and have a child there, she does not want. And so service provider's subjective views and moralistic considerations come into picture. The other thing is, in the context of the MPP Act, marital rape is not an offense. So the Section 3 framework will not even apply. So therefore, in the context of sexual autonomy and agency of a woman, if the pregnancy is caused due to rape within marriage, of course, this particular element of Section 3 will not apply. So I have a minute left. I quickly go through some recent instances of decriminalization and the way forward. So we've had examples of decriminalization, one in the context that everyone is aware of, Section 377 of the IPC, where criminalization of consensual sexual activity between same-sex couples was struck down by the Supreme Court, taking it within the fundamental rights framework and saying it violates the fundamental rights of these individuals. Similarly, Section 497 of the IPC, which dealt with the offense of adultery, was struck down by the Supreme Court recently. However, we should keep in mind that adultery continues to be a ground for divorce under matrimonial laws, and other legal remedies are available. So therefore, it's not as if the court says adultery is not an issue at all, but keeps it out of the criminalization framework. Section 309 of the IPC, attempt to commit suicide, which was a crime under the IPC, with the Mental Health Care Act of 2017, in certain circumstances where, as the Section 115 says, it's a question of severe stress, then that's taken out of the framework of the of Section 319, and the Supreme Court in Common Law versus Union of India, in the context of what is termed as euthanasia, lays down the framework for medical providers to provide situations where for withholding or withdrawing life, prolonging medical support, right? So therefore, again, this is a situation in which it is there is criminalization is taken out, but something else is provided. And that leads me to my final point on what is the way forward. Criminalization, as all of us know, is not the solution at all. It's always a quick fix method that legislatures use, and more nuance is required. Now, if deterrence was the framework that will deter women from aborting was the issue, then doesn't seem to do that at all. It seems to deter service providers from providing those services. Of course, the argument that abortion should not be used as a contraceptive method, the solution to that would be awareness and education rather than criminalization. There's a third argument that comes up regularly, that if abortion is not criminalized, it will lead to sex selective abortions. Of course, the one thing we always would say is do not conflate and educate as well on the issue of sex selection. But I think this is a point where we need to think about more on how to how this issue can be dealt with. And again, as Aparna pointed out right at the end, There's one model is a prohibition and regulation model, and the other is a charter of rights model, where you say that these are the services that a woman can access. In fact, the Justice Verma Committee in its report, this is a part of the report that nobody looks at, was the entire Bill of Rights that was recommended by the Verma Committee, in which there are 2 points. One is that no woman shall be unfairly discriminated on grounds of gender, including limiting access to healthcare. And the second was that every woman shall have a right to reproductive and sexual health. Sorry, that point has been repeated. So something like this, where you actually say that there is a framework, there are rights that can be that a woman has. So therefore, a law which is a more rights is more from a rights context rather than a situation where you're providing RMPs the power to make decisions, right? So a law providing the right to access abortions with the framework therein. Right? So that's briefly what I wanted to say, and happy to take any questions.
Well, thank you so much, Mrinal. That was a very thought-provoking presentation, and I'm sure many people have questions or comments to make on this. Can I request that anyone who wants to speak, please raise your hand using the raise hand function. We have time. It is now 2:40 almost, and we have time till 3:10 to have a discussion and responses from our two speakers. So yes, I can see Vinoj. Vinoj, would you like to go first?
Thanks, everybody. I have a clarification question on the flowchart that Aparna shared about the various laws around the abortion issue, where you have also mentioned, Aparna, about PCPNDT being an having an impact. Like, so till now, normally in all conversations, you know, like we have always tried to maintain that these are two distinct laws which don't, at a legal framework, intersect. At the ground level, they do. So I wanted to check, is there, why have you put it there?
Okay, no, my point was just about the ground level reality of how, so PCPNDT, of course, only prohibits sex determination. It actually does not talk about sex selection. But the way PCPNDT, we know, is enforced is through looking at through the lens of abortion. So all that I wanted to say was, when an RMP is deciding whether to provide abortion or not, this is the plethora of sort of legal frameworks that the RMP is looking at to see, you know, there might be legal consequences if I do provide this abortion. These are the legal consequences that might follow. This is not to say that the PCPNDT itself has this consequence, but on the ground level, this is the consequence that the RMP has to keep in mind. So I completely agree with you. I don't think we are in disagreement.
Thank you, Aparna. Vinoj, is that okay? Do you have a follow-on question?
No, as I said in chat box, I'm fine.
Okay, great. Sorry, I wasn't paying attention there. Dr. Malhotra?
I had a question with Aparna or Mrinal, for one, either of them. You know, since the MTP Act doesn't criminalize the woman in any way, in case a woman undergoes an abortion by a provider, she fulfills one of the conditionalities under Section 3, but any of the requirements regarding place or training and certification, in case they are not met, then the punishment is for the provider or in some cases the owner of the abortion site. So what I want to know is that if the provider gets punishment under the MTP Act, does the woman face any criminalization under the IPC then, in case one of the requirements is not fulfilled?
Yes. So here there's a legal answer and then there's a practical answer, right?
Okay, yeah.
The legal answer is that the entire MTP only exempts the RMP. It doesn't exempt the woman at all. So theoretically, you could say that even if, you know, it's just for the protection of the RMP, if a woman undergoes abortion, even following the provisions of the MTP Act, there is no protection for her because there's no exemption for her. But that's sort of an absurd interpretation to take, though there is that legal, it's a drafting problem. But yes, if the provisions of the MTP Act are not followed, then there are two sorts of consequences. Some consequences are under the MTP Act, which are only for the RMP and the owner of the place. But the consequences under the IPC also kick in. And those consequences are both for the RMT and for the woman. And it is in this context I was also saying that even where the RMP is protected, the woman might not be protected. Because if the RMP has followed all the provisions of the MTB Act, there's no criminal consequences on the RMP. But for the woman, there might be a range of civil consequences that still follow. Because the MTB does not give her a right to an abortion. It just tells us when the RMP can legally provide abortion. And that is the context in which in family matrimonial disputes, courts have said that if you seek an abortion without your husband's consent, which is not required under the MTP Act, but if you do it, then even if you follow the terms of the MTP Act, this amounts to cruelty for the purposes of divorce under matrimonial laws.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you, Aparna. Is there anyone else who has a question or a comment? Do you want to raise hand? Yes, Rupsha.
Thanks, Mrinal and Aparna. That was a really interesting and helpful input. You know, I had a question. I know both of you kind of shared the pros and cons of taking a decrim approach. But I was just wondering, even if we were to have, let's say, a model law or a, you know, a charter of rights, having the IPC as it is, would it not still, you know, in some way still interact with a progressive legislation? And how does that interaction take place? And also, so just that, and also what your views would be. Like in the case of 377, it was a reading down. It wasn't necessarily removing the entirety of the provisions that are there. So, you know, what would a more strategic approach be? Mrinal, as you were highlighting certain articles that are more problematic, would those provisions, like, is that sort of a interim approach that we could think about? I mean, I'd like to learn more or understand more, frankly.
Yeah, see, definitely. The thing is, you would you would have to keep some of the sections in the IPC. For instance, there's one section which says that if you cause homicide of the woman and in the process the fetus, both the woman die and then the fetus also dies in the process, then it is considered, it's punishable under one of those sections. So something like that you will have to keep. Similarly, the section 313, which deals with non-consensual abortions, I guess you should be keeping that. So therefore, you would remove those sections which are about, like what 377, what the Supreme Court did in 377, where they keep 377 to cover non-consensual sexual activity, because again, there's no framework to deal with that. So you would keep that. So therefore, you would definitely keep something like 313, but take out the three sections I mentioned, 312, 314, and 315. So therefore, there would definitely be an interaction with the IPC. So you have to take out those sections, remove those parts which criminalize choices made by women. But I think the point that both of us were making, and Aparna can add to this, is that you can't just take the IPC provisions out and say, okay, it's not a crime anymore, without providing a framework for provision of abortion services. Because if you don't do that, you will have situations where the RMP might just refuse to provide those services, saying, I don't want to. So there, I think the New Zealand law, the recent New Zealand law which came in March 2020, is interesting because it removes it, New Zealand criminal court had similar provisions. So they removed those provisions in the New Zealand criminal court and put down situations in which the provider has to, the RMP or whatever, the doctor has to provide abortion services. But interestingly, it also says that if a RMP has conscientious objections, then they have to tell the patient right up front that if at any point there's the woman were to seek an abortion, they will not provide it, and the hospital cannot penalize the doctor just on that ground. So it also provides some sort of rights framework for the doctor as well. So that is why I think both of us were saying that we need to have a charter framework rather than just leaving it to the Wild West of the law to deal with it. And that was the problem.
Thank you so much, Mrinal. Deepika, before I call upon you, if I could just ask one query of my own since we are talking about the IPC. Mrinal, I was wondering why you said the Section 316 does not apply? Because it says, as far as I can see, whoever does any act and thereby causes death of a quick unborn child. So is that not still intrauterine? I mean, it is still a termination of pregnancy, right?
Again, I think the point is that decriminalization is necessary, but it is not sufficient. And if we only went for decriminalization, then I think we would be we would run into a problem. So imagine a situation where we remove these IPC provisions. We remove these IPC provisions, the MTP Act might not be required in its present form at all because it's an exception. What do you get left with? You get left with a woman seeking abortion having to have a chance encounter with a RMP who is willing to provide those services. Now, whether the RMP provides those services or not depends on a whole range of considerations that the RMP might have, including a whole range of patriarchal beliefs and other value systems. So that is why decriminalization, if you remove the MTP framework, and we see this, right, of doctors telling us in our field work, telling us that, you know, I don't think abortion should be provided for a whole range of reasons, but the law provides it, so what can we do? So it's in that situation we said that if you only remove, if you only decriminalize and don't do anything else, that might be a problem. But for anything else to follow, for us to move towards safe, accessible abortion, we have to decriminalize. So the point is not to say don't decriminalize. The point is to say decriminalize plus.
Okay. Thank you, Aparna. I don't know if Mrinal is still looking at the provisions, but maybe I'll ask. Okay.
I found the provision. Can I share screen? Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
316 has an illustration in the IPC and has been read in that way. So I just want to show. Right. Although there may be cases, if you look at 316, it says whoever does any act under such circumstances that if he thereby causes death, he would be guilty of culpable homicide and does by such act cause the death of a quick unborn child, shall be punished with imprisonment. You see the illustration, it says A, knowing that he is likely to cause the death of a pregnant woman, does an act which if it caused the death of woman would amount to culpable homicide. The woman is injured but does not die, but the death of an unborn quick child with which she is pregnant is thereby caused. A is guilty of the offense defined in this section. So in my understanding, 316 is, like I was mentioning earlier, is confined to those situations where you're causing or attempting to cause the death of a pregnant woman and in the process cause the death of the quick unborn child as per the illustration. So the illustration would be used to interpret the section in this manner, which is why I said you might want to keep 316 for these circumstances. The other way of doing this is just to move 316 into relevant part of section 299, which deals with culpable homicide as an explanation. But that's a bit too much of trying to tinker with this. So that is why I felt that this provision does not necessarily deal with provision of abortion services, but it's to deal with a particular situation. Of course, there might be situations when 316 has been used in a different context, which in my understanding would not be the correct way to use it.
Right. Thank you so much for that explanation. Thank you, Deepika, for your patience. Can we ask Deepika to ask her question, please?
Yeah, hi. I don't have a question. I just wanted to add to what Aparna and Mrinal have said. I think so far we need to understand that so far the way we've been looking at legal reforms for abortion have been either through constitutional challenges or legal passages, which is within the exceptional framework of IPC, right? So the conversation about criminalization has not come up as such in any of the cases or in terms of reforms. Right now when we start looking at why do we need criminalization, actually one can look back and say, you know, it's really not coming in your way, why do you want to rake it up, right? But the first webinar we actually straightened it out through even somebody like Arvind's presentation, why we need it, because it causes stigma and discrimination, and it's a discriminatory provision. It also intimidates service providers. Now when we decriminalize IPC, you know, you have to, when we decriminalize IPC, the exceptional framework will have to go. But that is not to say that nothing else will remain. Obviously, there has to be something there. Now, the conversation has to be between, do we need an active legislation like Vietnam, where they have a pro-rights legislation, or do we want to go the way which Canada went? They decriminalized and they have like a basic charter, which is what Mrinal was talking about, where you don't actually have a legislation, because legislation comes with its own problems. And I think this is a discussion we need to have as a movement. as a group and multiple stakeholders on whether we need to go either way. Number one. Number two, whether we need to decriminalize 312 to 316 or 318, or whether we need to read down a few provisions which consensually, you know, even when a woman goes for abortion via consent, she's still criminalized. Do we need to decriminalize the non-consensual part, or do we need to actually do away with this criminal framework within abortion is a conversation we need to have. Like, for example, there are, in one of our meetings, Anuba and some others have expressed concerns with the fact that, you know, when a woman is when a woman goes through miscarriage because of domestic violence or other issues, then she needs a legal remedy. Now, whether the alternative justice model is important or legal remedy, I believe should also be a conversation, should not be pre-decided, because there is much anti-carceral conversation happening in the country today in context of many things. So we should also have a feminist conversation on these two issues. So these are the two things I wanted to flag as we move ahead in this conversation. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Deepika. Very valid points. Do the speakers want to say anything in response? Okay, then can I ask Anubha to please go ahead?
So not taking too much time, because a lot of what I wanted to say was covered by Deepika just now. But I agree that I think the conversation also needs to see, because there is no disagreement on whether reading down / decriminalization is one of the things that we're looking at. I think everyone, and please correct me if I'm wrong, I think most of us agree on that, that is definitely required. I think the conversation also that we need to start thinking about, like Deepika just pointed out, is what after that? Do we still want the MTP Act? We don't want the MTP Act. What do we want to do with all of that? Are we okay with just guidelines being there, like guidelines are there for anything else, any other medical procedure? Or, you know, or are we saying that why only abortion? There should be an overhauled reproductive rights legislation or health rights legislation, something to that effect. You know, so I think we also need to start thinking on those lines, because those are questions that we will be asked whenever we raise these concerns. That's all.
Thank you so much, Anubha, for keeping that brief. Shruti, I can see your hand up.
Yeah, thank you. So I had a question around the model of abortion laws that Aparna presented, and it is just for my understanding that I want to know a little bit more about the different models that she talked about, for example, Ireland, Australia, or New Zealand, especially in the context of, you know, access to abortion for minors or, say, underage children, and also for access for other marginalized communities. So maybe like looking at the laws and the different models that are existing in a bit, closer sort of look at those laws and nuanced understanding of those laws. And if you have, you know, on any understanding in terms of consent, especially consent of parents or spousal consent for children who are unmarried, for adolescents. So in that context, if you have any reflections right now, then I would like to understand that a little bit.
Thank you, Shruti. Do the speakers want to respond to that?
I want to respond to that. Can I share my screen?
Yes.
Just one second. Can you see my screen?
Yeah.
Yeah. So this is just a picture of, you know, what abortion laws look like globally. This is from the CRR website. And just to say is that, of course, you know, there's a whole range of different laws and different approaches that the world world over the countries have. I think in terms of defining our own model law, we need to think of what our goals are, one, what our non-negotiables are, and then how do we frame the law accordingly, right? What do we decriminalize? What do we not decriminalize? What do we legalize? What are the kinds of obligations that we put on the state or on RMPs? So that's a broad point. I'm not suggesting a model law. I'm saying that this is a conversation that we might want to have. And as a group, if we can coalesce around the model law, that gives some bite to our advocacy to say that, hey, here is an alternative that you can think about. Now, I was looking at, I'm by no means a comparative law expert on abortion laws, but I was looking at some countries that have looked at decriminalized abortion recently and have legislated recently, including Ireland, New Zealand, and New South Wales and Australia. And what definitely New Zealand and New South Wales have done is that, particularly for minors, they have put in protections to say that at least there's some amount of abortion care, as long as it is informed, there's information that is given, and the minor has an ability to understand the legal consequences, and the sort of the not just the legal but also the other consequences of going through that procedure, even if the person is not accompanied by and does not have the sign off of the guardian. Abortion services can be provided. We also have the benefit of international human rights standards, particularly under the CRC, the Child Rights Convention standards. Swagata can possibly speak about them more, which talk about a health-first approach to providing health services to and including reproductive and healthcare services to minors. So I think those are instruments that we can draw from. I think some of the other points that I would mention in that context is, one is both Australia and New Zealand are also concerned, as India tends to be and Indian policymakers tend to be, about sex selection. So what they have said is, instead of presuming that abortions are being performed majorly for sex selection, they have said, we will take a time frame where we will do evidence gathering on what is the impact of legalization of abortion on sex selection, and only then will be formulate a response. So that's one thing that they've done. Second is, of course, they've all said that the woman who's seeking abortion cannot be criminalized and penalized in any circumstance whatsoever. Third, interesting thing that they've done, which we might have an opportunity for, there's ambiguity in the language of the proposed amendments, is to say that up to a significant amount of time, the service provider does not have to be a special service provider under the law. It is any medical, any doctor. And we know that under the MTP Act currently, the person has to be a registered medical practitioner as per the terms of the rules and regulations. The MTP Act says that you will have different rules depending on gestational age on who is the RMP who is allowed to provide services. There is space for negotiation there to broad-based service providers, to limited to the medical, to the doctor community, but at least broad-base it to say that this does not only have to be OBGYNs, but at least up to a certain amount of time in the amount of gestational age, it can be any doctor. I think there are learnings of this sort that one can take from some of the other laws across the world, particularly laws that share the same history that we do in terms of criminalization of abortion.
Thank you so much, Aparna. So there has been a little bit of some chats on the side, so I'm going to ask you questions related to that. But I had one question, Aparna, before you go away from this map. If New Zealand decriminalized only recently, but they're still showing up as blue on this map, so this is what you were talking about, that although it was criminal, the legal provisions were actually very liberal. Is it in that context that New Zealand is showing up as blue?
So I should say, I don't know till when this website has been updated. I pulled it out this morning.
Okay.
File is here. She might have information on how frequently this map is updated. But New Zealand passed this law in March. So this is, I've pulled this out as of today.
Right, thank you. Payal is responding in the chat saying the map does not distinguish between criminal and legislative more generally. So that answers that. Thank you so much. Some of the other questions that have been coming up in the chat, and I'm going to just ask them on behalf of everyone. One is a little bit of clarity on what we mean by quickening, since that came up in the 316 provision. Is that supposed to mean just that the woman feels the fetus was meant to kind of be indicative of a period of viability? Is that what the legal provision was based on?
As I mentioned in the chat, the intent of the legislature is that one paragraph which I put up, so there's nothing in the notes to the IPC to see why they're making that distinction. So whether they thought about viability or otherwise, we don't know. Probably, but we don't know. The second is, the quickening as understood is a medical terminology. As soon as the movements are felt, I guess, is when the law defines that as quickening. So it would be a medical, I think that you would need medical evidence, if I'm not wrong, to show that there was a quickening was experienced. And so thereafter, it gets into the aggravated parts of each of the sections, because each section provides a different punishment if the woman was quick with child.
Right. Thank you so much. One more question I wanted to ask you, Mrinal, was about the IPC cases that you shared. Were all these cases, they were violations of the MTP Act? Do you have any background on what those cases were? And the male-female disaggregation that you had, was it dependent on the men or women in the family who were criminalized, or was it a disaggregation of the doctor's gender? Who was the IPC actually filed against?
No idea, because this is just the data that we have on the crime in India. But again, we should keep in mind that it might not be to do at all with sections 312 and 313, because we saw only 200 odd cases in 312 and 313, and they don't provide a sex aggregation, gender-wise aggregation in 312 and 313. So this might all be 316, 317, 318 as well. But it shows that taking the entire set of sections, there are 1800 cases in the last week.
Okay, thank you. Because some of us, last year we were in a meeting where someone mentioned that there has become a practice now for any cases which are put in under the sex selection issue, they are also adding IPC to it. So I was wondering whether that was the reflection, because we heard this story from someone in Rajasthan. So I was just wondering.
In Maharashtra, the health ministry website actually has a list of prosecutions under the MTP Act and under PCPNDT and under MTP Act. And again, it's from a PCPNDT focus. It's not from the focus of the MTP Act, but they tag on some of these MTP provisions, which say that, if you're doing it outside of the facilities, so those provisions get tagged on, and the IPC provisions get tagged on. So that information is available from Maharashtra.
Right. Thank you so much, Aparna. Sundari, would you like to ask your question or comment?
It's a question. From what I understand so far, we have a broad consensus in terms of at least some of the clauses from the criminalization to be removed. And then there was, a suggestion that we go either for a positive, for positive legislation within a rights framework, and whether that has to be broad in terms of SRH services or specific to abortion services, and going the Canada way. But my question in this context is, that when we bring in a positive legislation, are we saying then that it will replace the MTP Act?
And how does it work? Respond?
Yeah, I mean, I would think that we would, the current structure of the MTP is, there's a criminalization in IPC and an exception in MTP. So if the criminalization in IPC goes, the MTP Act by itself would go away as it is currently framed, right? So there would be no requirement for the MTP Act as such. So the in that sense, the question would be, what would you replace it with? You would need a new legislation. Now, one way to do that is to both decriminalize, take the existing MTP, tinker around with it, or have a completely fresh legislation. I mean, that's really, I wouldn't think too much of substance would flow from it. But I think the more important question would be, what would be the scope of that legislation? If we look at, again, comparative examples where they decriminalized, they ended up coming up with a new law. And I think the one reason behind that is that when social norms, there's a disjuncture between social norms and constitutional values, the gap to be filled, sometimes you need legislation to fill that gap. So, which is where just by removing the legislation is not going to be enough. You would need some sort of something to replace that. Whether that should be focused only on abortion, as countries like Australia or New Zealand have done, whether you want to have a broader SRH services approach, as for example Nepal or Vietnam have done, or whether you want to, those would be possibly two models that we might want to look at.
Thank you, Aparna. We are actually almost towards the end of our discussion time, but I had one question moving away from the decriminalization part to the amendments analysis. If you see one of the amendments proposed is that while maintaining the confidentiality of the woman, her identity can only be revealed to any law which is currently in power. So do you think that actually reduces the confidentiality at this current point? Because there are so many laws which could be considered to be taking a priority over her confidentiality, although the earlier MTP really went to many lengths, asking for it to be coded and then secret and locked and sealed, enveloped and all kinds of things. Whereas now it seems as though, for all you know, like an FDA which requires your medical abortion pills prescription to be in triplicate, one copy of which stays with the chemist, would that then actually reduce the protection of confidentiality?
I would think not. If you look at the current MTP Act, the confidentiality requirements come from state-based regulations. Whereas what this is doing is it is putting it in the app itself, saying that you have a confidentiality requirement, and if you breach that confidentiality, there are criminal sanctions to follow. I don't think we should go down the model of criminal sanctions again, because that creates perverse incentives. But having said that, the window given here of authorized by law is just so wide. For example, the big conflict between one big conflict between MTP and BCP and DT is that while MTP requires all sorts of confidentiality requirements, BCP and DT requires all sorts of documentation and filing of forms in multiple ID cards, age proof, etc. All of those things are required. So just on that basis, PCP NDT is so much broader. It covers any access to for a pregnant woman to be accessing services at all. Any sort of range of antenatal care would require that those kinds of services. Similarly, you have now these, I think Swagata mentioned in a previous webinar, these state level services, the Janani Suraksha Yojana type services, maternal healthcare services, such as PICNI in Tamil Nadu, which require registration, which require all sorts of documentation. And all of them are in that sense authorized by law. So I just think that authorized by law is just so wide that it will subsume everything. That's not to say that it's any different from what the law currently is, but even today the law allows for for disclosures based on authorization of law. So I would just say it's the same, possibly a little bit of a better protection, but the exception is just so wide that in practice a woman cannot be certain that her decision to abort and the abortion process is going to remain confidential.
Thank you so much, Aparna, for that clarification. Okay, we are now moving on to the next part of this webinar conversation. And I'm going to invite someone who actually has a very difficult task ahead of her, because she's going to be reviewing the areas and themes for advocacy that have emerged through these conversations for advocacy, either immediate, midterm or long term, and deliberations and identification of domains of agreement. So I would like to, it's my pleasure to welcome Renu Khanna. She is a founder trustee of SEHEJ, which is the Society for Health Alternatives based in Vadodara, Gujarat. It is a community-based action research and advocacy organization working on social accountability issues in the areas of maternal health, child rights, adolescent development. And she's actively engaged in several pro-people's networks like the Jan Swasthya Abhiyan, Common Health, Kopasa, Medico Friends Circle, etc. So Renu, you have 10 minutes to summarize and give us the themes for advocacy.
Okay, so thank you very much. It's a very difficult task indeed. I think each one of these webinars has been exceptional, and it's going to be quite difficult to, because this present discussion was so intense and so exciting that I feel that it's a pity to interrupt this discussion right now. However, the task that you've given me is to review the objectives of this entire series and to see what has happened in the earlier two webinars and to sort of highlight what the emerging themes are. So I will go ahead and I'm going to request you to, you know, when it's 8 minutes, in case I'm running over time, just to let me know when I have about 2 minutes left.
I'll do that. Thank you.
So the expected outcome of these series was to strengthen cross-movement alliance on decriminalization of abortion. That's the title. But we've had very wide-ranging discussions, not only on decriminalization and the legal aspects, but also on programmatic aspects and access to services. And one of the other themes which has been coming up, you know, over and over again, is that it's not just litigation, but that we also need to address stigma, mindsets, and larger societal you know, attitudes and thought processes. One of the other things which was stated upfront was to bring together PCP and DT activists, disability rights groups, access to safe abortion for all persons, adolescents, and especially vulnerable groups like adolescents, trans people, sex workers, single women, and others. And we have also spent some time learning from decriminalization of SRHR issues like homosexuality and sex work. Some very important lessons learned have been highlighted for us. So what are some of the emerging themes? I think probably in the second webinar, we felt that there is a consensus on what our position on safe abortion access is, that it's a right and moving away from or going beyond the public health framing and framing it in terms of reproductive autonomy, control over one's body, and access to safe abortion services as a reproductive right and as well as a right to the highest attainable standard of health. And I think this is something which has been reinforced today in the last discussion that, you know, presentations that we've had, where we've been mooting a positive sort of legislation which will guarantee access to services. Now, one of the other points which was made was that our articulation should be acceptable to all stakeholders and constituencies, allies, and however we might like to term them, that we should not inadvertently violate rights of other groups. And therefore, it is very, very important to have wide-ranging allies in these discussions and to build consensus in not just our position, but also the articulation and the language that we use. So this, I feel, is the first task which actually requires to be done. What was mentioned in the first webinar was that framing is important, and framing needs to be wide, you know, a broader sort of framing of our advocacy agenda. And for legal framing of our position, we may draw upon all the progressive judgments, which have been mentioned again today, like the right to privacy judgment or the Bombay High Court judgment. As Arvind was reminding us, go back to the archives and find favorable judgments, bring all of those out. In the light of today's discussion, it seems, and I'll come to some of the other aspects a little later, but it seems that not just the Indian judgments, but we also may need to refer to other countries' laws. So one of the other things which is which we've been highlighting over and over again is access to safe abortion by specific groups, and not just specific groups at all times, but also at special times like these. And one of the objectives of this current webinar is in the post-pandemic period, how do we ensure or guarantee safe abortion access to all people? And Vinoj had specifically mentioned how contraceptive access to contraceptives reduced during this period, how access to abortion services reduced, and keeping all of that in mind is how the framing will need to be done. And creating a community around this issue with their narratives and stories. So one of the other points that I wanted to make was that, as I was mentioning, that one, the first task that we need to do is to really have a very clear articulation of what our position is. And as insiders, we use certain language which all of us understand. But when we are talking about, for instance, the changing of social mindsets, you know, of the larger community and different people in that community. For instance, if we're talking about the judiciary, we're talking about service providers, and we're talking about community stakeholders, how do we translate that position into language which will be accessible to different, you know, these different constituents of our community? I think that is one task which really needs to be done whenever we get to that. But today's discussion, for instance, is sort of highlighting that further clarity is required. Lots more conversations are required on what exactly decriminalization means. As we've been saying today, does it mean repeal of those certain sections of the IPC 312 to 315, reading down of those? What does legalization mean in terms of the MTP Act? And we brought in this third dimension of a rights-based obligation, you know, a model law and a model law for access to safe abortion services, but also access to reproductive and sexual health services. And so, you know, these are the questions in front of us. And as we've been saying, further conversations are required. So what is our legal position? Or demand and articulation of that is required. I think one of the other points, thanks, I'll finish in 2 minutes. One of the other points which was made was that what does guardianship or consent mean in terms of minor girls or women or girls with disabilities? So these are certain areas of further clarity where we need to do more work. And then there are these questions of who are we going to advocate to? Are we going to be advocating to Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Ministry of Law, demographers, if we're talking about the population policy, population control, two child norm aspect which comes in? Are we going to be talking to the FOCSI as influencers, FOCSI as providers, service providers, to change mindsets for upholding professional ethics? Are we going to also be influencing medical education? So these were some of the conversations which were happening during these three webinars. And today's has gone back to, and rightly so, to the legal frameworks. And for us to clarify even more, what it is that we mean when we are talking about decriminalization. And one of the things which came out very clearly for me today is that we are not just talking about decriminalization. We are actually going beyond decriminalization. We're going back to, you know, access to safe abortion as a reproductive right of all persons. And what does that entail legally, in terms of the legal reforms which are required, and also in terms of what we need to do at the societal level Who do we need to ally with? Who do we need to work with in order to also be working towards the changing of mindsets against gender discrimination and equality for women and girls? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Renu. I think that was an amazing job you did with a very, very challenging situation of, you know, exploring the domains of advocacy. I think you identified ideological as well as practical. We're going to have another series potentially to discuss all the questions that have arisen from these. But if you could just use the raise function, we would really love to hear from those of you who've been a part of these three webinars. Yes, Sundari, please go ahead.
Just a quick thought that I had about, you know, my own thinking on the legal is that, I mean, it seems unfortunate that we have spent so many years tinkering with the MTP Act when it seems way more sensible to dump it and go for a rights-based, a positive legislation. And I'm just stating my position. That's broader than just abortion, but goes for sexual and reproductive health and rights. And such a positive legislation should deal with issues of consent and, you know, the rights of adolescents, drawing on practices for contraception and other reproductive health services for minors in several other countries, and, you know, also deal with problematic provisions in the mental health law, which may not, give people with certain mental health issues full rights and so on. So it has to be quite a comprehensive law if we are putting our efforts into it. I agree with Renu about all the other areas of changing mindsets and all that, but I feel that maybe we could focus a little bit more on this, at least as one major strand of conversation on what different people think. That would be good.
Thank you so much, Sundari. Is there anyone else who would like to speak? Rupsha, yes, please go ahead.
There's one point that I wanted to make that Sundari has already made. I do think we need a much more deeper dive into thinking through consent, but also through the framework of legal capacity. And I alluded to that in the first webinar. We now have the Mental Health Care Act and the Rights of Persons with Disability Act that also in a way interact with some of this, you know, on issues of post-abortion, etc. And so definitely, I think a deeper dive into that, because, there's an extremely problematic provision within the MTP Act that I feel we haven't interrogated enough or thought about enough, even as, you know, there's a new set of amendments that's on the anvil. The other issue I wanted to flag, which is that, you know, of course, for this webinar, we were clear that we were not going to look at the issues of sex selection and just the sort of ground level ways that the conflation has happened for now 3 decades. And I suspect, and in many ways, I see a corollary to the way that the sex worker rights movement has had to constantly juggle between the imperatives of, the anti-trafficking and sex workers' rights. And in that, to think through in a very nuanced way how to articulate issues of decriminalization or some sort of legal reform. And I suspect that the same kind of complexity, and, you know, I remember Tejasvi saying that even though the sex workers' rights movement was much ahead in beginning to think about decriminalization decades before, you know, the whole discussions on decriminalization of homosexuality began and got so much success is precisely because of that complexity and the muddled nature of that conversation. And I suspect that for us, willy-nilly, we'll have to go into that fault line because it is so much, I keep saying, in the psyche of whether it's our policy makers or an average person, that any kind of wide, broad-based consultation, public discourse, forget about, coming to the formal policy-making phase, there has to be a way for us to begin to do that. So I just wanted to say that to me, it seems that, you know, moving forward, there has to be a way that we need to begin to start thinking of this, because there was no way that anything, even the Charter of Rights, issues of reproductive autonomy, that's on the one side. And definitely, I think Renu mentioning, and it came up in the second webinar, the whole reemergence of the population control discussions at the highest levels of policy making also remains very problematic. And those are, I feel, just additional complexities we'll have to take on board at some time or the other.
Thank you so much, Rupsa. Aparna?
Yeah, thank you. Just two reflections. One is, Rupsha already mentioned, but the mental health implications of the MTP Act are very, very problematic. So it says that, you know, anyone who has a mental illness that is not mental retardation, this is the language of the MTP Act, requires consent of the guardian. And this, of course, actually flies in the face of the RPD Act and provisions of the Mental Health Care Act. So both, I would think, there are short-term goals that can be accomplished in looking at some of these discrepancies and addressing those, but also at the same time not losing sight of the larger goal of where we want to be. I just wanted to flag that one of the discussions that we had in the earlier webinars was also to engage with the medical education community to see how we can work with medical service providers to ground their understanding of abortion access in rights-based in rights-based approaches. I have some which if we get the time towards the end, I can share on what textbooks, medical textbooks really say about this. And the third point I very quickly wanted to make, I think that the sex selection, sex workers movements also highlight the need for going beyond decriminalization in a way, because under the law, the provisioning of sex work is itself not an offense, but everything surrounding it is, right? So soliciting is, living off the earnings of a sex worker is, etc. So all the sort of the support mechanisms and everything surrounding the act of provision of sex work it has been criminalized. So decriminalization of that just one small bit doesn't really help. And the analogy and the corollary here would be that even if you take away the criminalization of the woman, but you leave everything else within the criminal law framework, or even within the sort of legal regulation framework, then the legal suppression framework, then we may end up in not achieving the goals that we've set out for ourselves.
Thank you so much, Aparna. I don't see anybody else's hands raised, but I'm just going to call upon a couple of people, not to put you on the spot. If you would like to, it would be lovely to hear from you. Simply because I think one of Renu's points, which she brought out very clearly, was we need to advocacy needs to be legal, of course, but it's very complex. There are many other domains of advocacy. So I was wondering whether people who have experience with cross-movement work or of community-level advocacy or non-legal forms of advocacy want to just speak out and share any thoughts. So I'm just going to ask if Kalpana, if she's still on the call, and Manisha Gupte or anybody else wants to speak to those components of the advocacy landscape that we are likely to have to navigate going forward. Kalpana, yes, Kalpana, thank you. Please go ahead.
Yeah, should I speak? Yeah, okay. Thank you, Suchitra. First of all, I think it's a very nice webinar. All the three episodes, I could say that it really, where they work together well. All the issues. So, and also Renu, of course, so much food for thought. When we look at safe abortions and community advocacy, I think for community advocacy, it's a very powerful strategy, community advocacy for rights, really. But when we look at safe abortions and the right to safe abortion, a lot of work needs to be done at the community level for women to be able to realize. And that's why the work that we do on stigma and discrimination, basically abortion stigma, it's so deep. I mean, we've worked around stigma on HIV positive people, but that stigma itself, it took like decades to address, and there still is. But abortion, since it's sexuality, the stigma around accessing safe abortion, even in a woman's mind, is so deep that we will have to first, before we can have community advocacy as a strong strategy for claiming their rights, there's a lot of work that needs to be done with women themselves. That's first thing I would like to say. And I think that that ultimately, for all that we do, it will have to be, it has to be women themselves, and we will need to work with women to see that the ask and the need is very powerfully then orchestrated. Because all this while, and we've said it many times, that the MPP Act really is not an empowering act. We know that it is not rights perspective. We are coming to it from a health perspective, and that's why there is this whole that's not bad. I would say, okay, fine, from a health perspective also, it's a different ball game altogether. But if you look at it from right, I always believe, why should there be an act of parliament for women to access abortion? That it in itself, however we may frame it, however, there are going to be lacunae in that. So unless we work on the ground level and create those capacities that women can then take over the movement, and that movement can then demand for rights, it has to be. Otherwise, we will go on doing next 10 years, we will go on talking about various issues, and we still will not be able to see that safe abortions becomes a right for women in India. So I'll stop there.
Thank you so much, Kalpana. That is, I think, a very sort of practical considerations of how the movement needs to go forward. Thank you for your thoughts. May I request Manisha Gupte, please?
Yeah, thank you, Suchitra, for inviting me. At the community level, and some issues that I raised in webinar too also, I think the first is to talk in the community, and completely agree with the Kalpana about stigma, because stigma around abortion exists even for women within marriage. It's not something that is completely stigma free. And then, of course, if your status is anything beyond cohabiting married woman, then it only gets worse. And I think stigma really needs to be addressed very seriously, because in many researches, including the one that some of us did with Sehat, was that women were ready to compromise every aspect of quality of care just to maintain confidentiality. And also transportation, they wanted to go as far as possible to have the abortion rather than as near as possible. And rather than with known people, they would rather have unknown people. They also don't want to meet the provider again many times, because of the fact that the provider might be with somebody else, or they might be with somebody else, and the knowledge that they had at an abortion would come out. So I would say from there, from stigma, that is one. The second is the social need for many abortions. Actually, it's socially constructed, right? If there were no stigma about, now I'm going to stigma not just related to abortion, but to, sexuality within patriarchy. If there had been no stigma about sexuality outside of marriage, many of the abortions would not actually even be required by women. If I had social security to raise a child outside of marriage, if now, of course, there are laws in which the child has property rights with the father, but then paternity has to be, not just biologically proven, but also socially proven. So all these issues exist, and so therefore, stigma of just sexuality within patriarchy. I think these are two issues, and we then therefore cannot, of course, ignore the fact of the patriarchal marriage at one end, patriarchy which creates the wife at one end and the sex work at the other end, because one is so-called for reproduction and the other is the other for non-reproductive sexuality. From there, I would say that the rights-based approach is important, because then we are able to point a finger specifically and say, where is the barrier and who is responsible for the person to be able to access the abortion. So therefore, then the responsibility moves from the person who is having the abortion to the person who is supposed to provide that abortion. At the time of getting the abortion, no questions really should be asked. And so therefore, a rights-based approach is very important. I'm quite excited and also jittery that, you know, how we are all going to navigate first the decriminalization as one step, and then to say that we want a positive act. I'm very, very excited that we maybe over the next 5 years, you know, all of us together can think of a more positive act. Only that how it's going to happen, and in this the shrinking democratic spaces, what is going to happen. The last point that I want to make is that we need to go beyond the rights-based approach, because laws, one law, you know, sometimes is in opposition with another law. And how many laws are we going to look into to see at what point a good lawyer from the husband side, here I'm specifically using the word husband side, would be able to come out and say that there was this particular act, part of this act in some particular law that could still criminalize the woman. And so therefore going to the human right to sexual and reproductive health and rights. And there, if we can go to the international treaties, maybe when the India goes for the next CEDAW hearing, we could write something on abortion as a right. And so therefore, one, the highest attainable standards of health and the non-discrimination and the state obligation, etc. So I think, you know, we probably have to pitch also in the human rights framework with the autonomy, personhood, etc. And I think that probably, you know, how we do it all together, I'm sure we can do it. It's a hard task ahead, but I've never been so excited about issues related to abortion as I am now, because this is really something is happening. And next year, which is the 50th year, I think we should really come together with some kind of loud noise, which is heard not only here, but also whenever India goes for universal periodic reporting to many of the treaties that it has signed and ratified. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Manisha. I think that was really an excellent sort of final remarks for this discussion. And although we have 7 minutes left, I think I don't want to sort of, force us to continue if people don't have any further remarks to make. So is there anyone else? Speak now or forever hold your peace. I'm just going to give half a second if anyone wants to raise their hand. But I think that was really excellent sort of summing up, even from Manisha, from the perspective of cross-movement and future steps. So I'm going to now invite Alka and Renu, Alka and Rupsha, sorry, to give their closing remarks and next steps. Rupsha, are you going first?
I could go first. Thanks, Sachitra. I just want to once again thank everyone for their participation, contribution. I think it's been a really excellent collaborative space that I think it is exactly the way I think Common Health and Priya envisioned the webinar series. And I think everybody just owned the space, and we've just really had fantastic, rich discussions, I think, that we'll continue to think about and distill. So just first, some short-term things I think that Common Health and Priya would like to do, just with just this very, very rich content and discussions that we've generated through these three webinars. So we've certainly had someone, Shreya, she's been on these webinars, who's helped us with a very detailed documentation. We've had another colleague who's helped us do graphic recording, and we've of course been recording all your presentations. And I think speaking to the point that many people have made here about how do we broad-base this and how do we take it wider and generate a much more of a broad-based conversation, because this was really a smaller group of people who pretty much, I would say, have been part of these discussions for decades and, you know, in some form or the other. So I think we're very committed to thinking through in terms of producing some of this material as soon as possible and putting it out in the public domain. And we'll probably consult some of you. We'll certainly take your consent before we put out anything. And so that's a kind of a short-term immediate goal. I think the other thing I was thinking, and it occurred to me, is that clearly, especially today, and I think in the first place, I think this webinar series and the need for it emerged from the meeting that Common Health had hosted last year in December, where many of us had said that we really need to understand, you know, what does it look like? What is this decriminalization that we use the word, but we really need to unpack it. And I think we've done a lot of unpacking of these various terms that we tend to use very broadly. And I feel there's, of course, a growing clarity. And I think all of us are kind of coming to the same page in terms of understanding and interpretation of what we see. But I feel like that needs to continue. So one of the things I was thinking is if there was a possibility through some of the other colleagues that we work with globally to see if we could access maybe colleagues from some of the countries that were mentioned today by Aparna, and I think it's come up in the past as well, to see in some of the countries where they've come up with some of these more rights-based legislation and or moved in the direction of decrim, what were those processes? I mean, of course, the context varies, but I thought just creating some of these internal learning opportunities for us. I mean, this is a long haul. I think it's not, as Manisha rightly said, you know, decades of activism precede any meaningful change in law or decrim. So I feel like, I think I can safely say on behalf of Common Health and CREA that obviously we view this as a longer term commitment in both our organization's mission and vision. We're very much committed to advancing safe abortion, thinking of it as a right to the highest attainable standard of care, but also thinking of it through a rights-based lens. And so I think we certainly as organizations are committed to doing that. The only other thing I want to say is CREA and Common Health have been collaborating for the last 5 years, and we've been partnering, in fact, exactly to create a landscape where the conversation on abortion is much more broad-based. You know, when we first started the work, our assessment was that there really wasn't a critical mass of people out there within movements, within community-based organizations who are having the conversations that we saw were happening in smaller groups, in the bigger cities. And so we set out to put together, building on Common Health, Common Ground workshops, which they were doing for some years, and CREA's experience of doing institutes such as the Sexuality, Gender and Rights Institute. And we started the Abortion, Gender and Rights Institute, which we've now held 4 times in the last five and a half years, with the idea that, provide a critical learning and thinking space for perspective building for a broad-based set of people, you know, activists, practitioners, working on a range of issues. We conduct these institutes in Hindi. So the other thing, we certainly recognize that the language barrier, that often a lot of the knowledge, the resource, the critical thinking that has been going on is not accessible to a large number of people. And in the process of doing that, we've really worked with, over the 3 and 4 institutes, we've kind of had about 70 plus people, mostly from the Hindi-speaking states. So in the last year, we opened it up more nationally. And so we had participants from other states who were proficient in Hindi attend. We had coupled that with a very active alumni engagement strategy. So post-institute, really going back and engaging with them at the state level. And so I think one of the other things that directionally we are thinking as Common Health and CREA is just use some of the resources that we've managed to generate out of these webinars, make it more accessible in a local language, particularly Hindi. And we have plans to maybe hold, not in the exact format, but similar sessions with some of the people who've been part of our institute as part of some concrete steps to really take the conversation outwards. And we hope that we will also, you know, this is a, you know, we will try to keep the conversation ongoing with all of you through some emails, etc., and would also welcome very much ideas or offers to maybe lead on specific things. I certainly feel discussions with the medical community is needed, so that they are also kind of beginning to understand some of this, and I don't know whether they'll be on the same page. But I think I was noticing on the chat there was a lot of indication and suggestions from several participants about how do we really take it outwards. And it's been done. I mean, you know, I remember during when the Domestic Violence Act was being deliberated, a lawyers collective took it all over the country through various processes, and it really became a larger movement conversation. And I think that's one thing. And then, so again, I mean, I do think that Common Health and CREA saw this as a very collaborative, co-created space with all of you. And we would, you know, reach out to you continually to get your suggestions, inputs. But just to say that as two organizations, we are committed to continuing to, you know, at least create a space for us to continue to have these conversations in the coming months and years. And over to you, Alka.
I'll just add to whatever Rupsa has said. We do have a plan of going through the themes identified and look at these in terms of not just advocacy at national, state, and local or ground level, but also look in terms of immediate, midterm, and long-term advocacy efforts. The couple of things we right now have absolutely clearly planned is, you know, generate evidence and come up with stories, something which Arvind talked about in the first webinar. We do have information or stories about access, but we do not have too much information about what happened to cases which went through, went to the courts and what happened later on. Now, how do we get that information? All that needs to be thought further, but that's one of the things, plans we have. The other thing, in addition to what Rupsa talked about, common ground workshops and capacity building of local advocates at the ground level. We are also thinking in terms of allied and partner organizations, not only in terms of who are present here, but also involving those who are at the absolute ground level, and perhaps maybe even representation of women themselves, their voices in sort of, doing this advocacy further. But for that, before that, we'll have to sort of create the kind of awareness Dr. Malhotra has talked about at the community level. We create more awareness, more talk about these issues more in the context of women's rights. So that is what we have right now in mind. But we are open to suggestions, and the conversations we had, the webinars we had, the response has been so overwhelming. So there is always a temptation to take this further. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Rupsha and Alka. I think Rupsha has been posting something in the chat, so I'm just going to share it aloud. That the immediate next steps will be to produce material from the three webinars in multiple formats, videos, graphics, short reports, and blogs, do similar sessions with wider constituencies in Hindi, and Common Health would contribute to evidence building and collecting stories. So I think it has really been an excellent series of webinars, and I don't want to keep anyone waiting anymore. I think all of us have, you know, plenty of online work going on right now. So just to say a really heartfelt thank you to all of you who participated, joined in, stayed engaged, and to all our speakers for all the three webinars. And definitely to Rupsha and Alka and Rupsha's team at CREA, which helped us, with the Zoom platform and recording everything. So big thank you to everyone. And hopefully we will be in touch soon with the reports as well as the next steps. Thank you all.